Can you put it on the right one? I'm here to proselytize for the integration of geneticists with ophthalmologists. I think it will be of benefit to both of the groups. And I don't think this integration has reached its maximum. I'm one of five ophthalmologists in the US who are board certified in ophthalmology and in genetics. So it's a little bit the Wild West out there. How commonly do patients with genetic blindness remain underdiagnosed or have a new disease? Undiagnosed ophthalmologists miss von Hippel-Lindau syndrome disease. Should certainly be obvious, but unless there is really massive disease, ophthalmologists don't get it. And they miss Fabry disease. Misdiagnosed are Leber's congenital amaurosis as intrauterine infection. And underdiagnosed and unknowns are such, you know, common diseases. The epilepsy of the ophthalmologist as open-angle glaucoma. They're late-onset diseases and affect 2 or 3%, but they clearly run in families. Age-related macular degeneration, senile cataracts are all in that group. How many genetic diseases with ocular involvement are there? 1/4 to 1/3 of all genetic diseases are purely ocular or systemic with ocular involvement. So it's a tremendous impact. And if you go through OMIM and you read the report, it's just very clear that the numbers are very high. So there are common diseases which may be clinically insignificant, such as color blindness, or the diseases I mentioned before with late onset, well after the era when people procreate. And there's the rare diseases, and then there are new diseases. And an estimated 2 of 10% of patients remain undiagnosed after visiting an ophthalmologist. Obviously, it's a frustration. It also obviously depends on who the ophthalmologist is you see. I'm going to just say a few words about a very rare disease, Leber's congenital amaurosis, which is a disease where the retina does not function from birth. And it affects about 1 in 50,000 to 1 in 100,000 newborns. About 20 years ago, a major effort was put into trying to identify the few expected genes for this disease. And by now, there are 19 solidly confirmed ones, and another 11 where there is a sort of a single family not confirmed in a second family, or the mechanism is relatively unclear. And at present, when looking at a large series, 30 to 35% of patients remain undiagnosed at the DNA level. So in spite of having a certainly significant number of genes, there are still a lot of patients who are not diagnosed at the appropriate level and for whom certainly treatment is at far away at the horizon somewhere. The Leber's congenital amaurosis is a disease in which in one subtype, the RPE65 mutation group, have seen treatment approaches in the last 10 years and have gained much notoriety for it. If you look at the basic pathways that are known for Leber's congenital amaurosis, they go all over the photoreceptors, from vitamin A cycle to photoreceptor development, and but a large number are actually here in the cilium and have similar features to the Bardet-Biedl syndrome, for example, which is not part of this disease group. But most of those subtypes have at least one center that is interested in developing treatment for the group, and we are involved in creating and finding treatment for patients with CRM1 mutations. Thus, there is clear-cut progress thanks to a big effort into identification of genes which are causative for this devastating disease of lifetime blindness. Where are the sources of identification for identification of undiagnosed patients and new diseases? Much progress in these diseases has happened in the Middle East, in the countries in which there is a high rate of inbreeding, and there are centers and people all know each other worldwide who work in this field. And there has also been close to the mainland US, a lot of progress in Puerto Rico, looking at Puerto Rican patients, which has still a large impact of a founder effect in many centers in which diseases are present there in the mountains and in various areas. Mechanisms of teaching. What has happened in ophthalmology and genetics? There's the Ophthalmic Genetic Study Club, which is in its 40 years of existence, and it is open, and people come from all over the US and worldwide to participate in this. And one day where everybody shows their rare and unusual and undiagnosed patients in order to see how this can be moved forward. That has grown into an International Society for Genetic Eye Disease and Retinoblastoma, which meets every 2 years. The requirement of board certification and management of patients with genetic diseases has to be seriously considered because everybody does it according to their interests. I think what needs to happen and what would be great would be do a detailed geographic mapping using geographic information systems for patients and countries in order to move this forward. It's already happening in ophthalmology for trachoma, for, you know, basically other ophthalmic diseases, but not very seriously for the genetic eye diseases. In summary, I have not touched on all of this, but every part of the eye will show genetic diseases. There are thousands, 2,000, who knows how many, 2,500. So it goes from the front of the eye, from the lids, from the lashes, from the cornea, conjunctiva, conjunctiva, lens, to the retina and the optic nerve. Thank you.